any of you look at Saturn with the naked eye, I defy any of you to tell me you can see rings up there. Yeah, I don't think it's possible. So how did the ancients know there were rings?
Oh, yeah. That's a very good question. And why is there a hexagram, a six-pointed hexagram on the North Pole of Saturn? That's another one, too, for you.
I mean, that is.
Yeah, a hexagram on Saturn. And I sent you an email just now.
I'm looking at it.
I was going to talk about how the name for God is the word God in Hebrew is E-L-L. But the God of the ancient Saturnian people that we call the Hebrews was, they said that his name was four letters, which today we refer to it, the spelling of God's name is called the Tetragrammaton. And it's the Tetragrammaton, A-T-O-N, Tetragrammaton.
Like Aton?
Aton was a son in Egypt. The Aton was a son in Egypt. So that's why you have the four letters of the Hebrew alphabet put together for the name of God, and they call that the Tetragrammaton. And when you take those four letters in the Hebrew and put them together in a configuration in a circle, they become a swastika. And I just sent you a picture of that.
I see it identically. Now, for you folks, just imagine a swastika, if you will, and take the four arms and pull them directly away from center. Pull the top one up, pull the left one to the left, pull the right one to the right, and then you've got an open space in the middle. And you have, basically,
right,
if you look at it, you'll have four L's in a circle. L, 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 L. And in the center would be a circle. Now, you have something else in the center on this drawing.
And this is not my drawing. This is from a Jewish reference work.
But that's the point, that these four L's make the swastika, and it stands for the sun walking across the sky. Interesting.
Mm-hmm. And so the Hebrews were involved in sun worship. They were involved in moon worship. They were involved in Saturnian or Saturn worship. They've been involved in the worship of Jupiter. It's very interesting when you go back into the history of the Phoenician Canaanite people that we today call Hebrews. And see, the Hebrew language is not an exclusive language. This is what people have no idea about, that the Hebrew, when we talk about speaking the Hebrew language, when first of all, there is no such a thing as a Hebrew language, period. There is a Phoenician Canaanite language, which we call Hebrew. And the reason why is because the people we call Hebrew speak this language, and it's a Phoenician Canaanite language, but the Hebrews speak it. So we say, well, it's Hebrew. No, it's not Hebrew. It's Phoenician Canaanite. It's a Phoenician language, but the Hebrews speak it. So understanding that, now you can go into the ancient Phoenician Canaanite gods and see how the Hebrews have brought those ancient Phoenician Canaanite pagan gods into the modern-day world, and the symbolism, the occult symbolism of the swastika, the five-pointed star, the pentagram, the symbols on the synagogues, the symbol of the in Islam and Mecca, that goes back to the old Saturnian symbol for Saturn in the ancient Arabic world. Islam is nothing more than the worship of the planet of Saturn, and the Mecca is the old black square, and anybody who's done any research on the ancient god Saturn knows that that was one of the symbols in the Arabic world for the planet Saturn, was a black square, and it was called the Kaaba, which was a black cube, and there's a whole study of the black cube, the black square, in relation to the planet Saturn, and there's a whole study going on about the connection between the tetragrammaton name for God in Hebrew, going back to the swastika, You know, and so many of the, most people don't realize that four-fifths of all the Jews on the earth are not Semitic. That's another big subject of mine that I'm just amazed that people, you know, use terms that they don't understand. But four-fifths of the Jews on the earth are not Semitic to start with. They're called Ashkenazi, N-A-Z-I, Ashkenazi. And so there's a definite connection between the ancient Semitic peoples, the ancient Sumerian peoples, I mean to say, ancient Sumerians, the ancient Hindus, the sun god Aton in Egypt, and how all of this stuff has evolved over and mutated over the centuries, over thousands of years. It's mutated, evolved, and comes to us today as the Hebrew religion, the Islamic religion of Muhammad, the Christian religion. All of these ancient religions come from the same source. It goes back into an ancient world of occultism, mysticism. All three major religions require a book. And so they're referred to as the people of the book. And what is the bottom line on the religion of the people of the book, Islam, Judaism, and Christianity, if it isn't the lunacy and the mind-boggling stupidity and ignorance that is displayed all over the world?
I like you and have no reason not to.
I like you and have no reason not to.
Hey, did you hear about that magic baby that was born in Bethlehem?
People are killing each other over ancient pagan gods that they have no idea in the world of where these ideas and concepts have come from.
Yeah, and so
I'm just amazed.
It is true, and so easily manipulated into killing each other. Just a joke.
That's right.
A joke. All right, we'll take another break here and come back with Jordan Maxwell in just a minute.
Elohim. Yep. Genesis 1:1 says in English, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. But as I said, that's not what it says in the original. It says in the beginning Elohim created the heavens and the earth, not El. Elohim. Elohim is not El. It's El with a plural. So the correct translation should be, in the beginning, the gods created the heavens and the earth. And so, you know, this, we've talked about this before, but I think it's very important because it implies that there's something going on here and you're misunderstanding God. You're misunderstanding what God is. And so that's why in Genesis 1:28, when God is creating, you know, Adam and Eve, he said, it says, and God said, come, let us make man in our image after our likeness.
It's right there.
Right there. Come, let us. Well, first of all, to come, let us means that somebody is asking for a consensus among a group, you know.
Yeah, a committee. No wonder they screwed up so badly.
Yeah. And that's why I'm thinking that if it, like my rabbi friend told me many years ago, read it correctly. It doesn't say God created man. It doesn't say that in the Bible anywhere, God created man. What it says is that God said, come, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Not make man, let us make him in our image. And now, then a couple of scriptures later said, now see, and now man has become as one of us. He's like one of us now. Why? Because now he's smart, he's clever, he's writing poetry and building rockets and lasers and television. See, man has become as one of us, very clever, very smart. And now look what you've done. You've created a mess, because look at them. Now they're trying to play God. They're getting ready to go out into space and bring their bombs, and so now they have become like us. And then, of course, in Genesis 9:1, or after the flood, God says to Noah and his family, after the flood, they come out, and God says, go forth, multiply, and replenish the earth. And I asked the rabbi, is that a correct translation? He said, yes, the word is replenished in the Bible. So replenish means do it again. Well, that's obviously, if there were people on the earth and a flood came and wiped them all away, then if you're going to have people, you're going to have to replenish, do it again. And, of course, in Genesis 1:28, when God's creating Adam and Eve, he says the same thing, go forth, multiply, and replenish the earth. But what it's saying is that Adam and Eve were not the first, couple at all. It's let us make man in our image. And replenish the earth. Do it again. So I'm just saying that we need to find out what's really going on here. Mm-hmm. How did we humans get here? What is this thing about God?
Right.
And then you get all of these other silly, nonsensical religious programs that is just mockery.
They're just wacko.
Totally wacko. So.
Yeah. Well, the question I have is, have we as a species been here before and blown it? And I think the answer is yes.
Yeah, I wouldn't be a bit surprised. I think I'll tell you one other thing that is an absolute fact that very few people realize, and that is that the Earth has been the home to enormous, incredible civilizations of extraordinarily high technology that we can't even begin to figure out that technology. The Earth has been the home to thousands of civilizations, probably hundreds of millions of years ago. And we know that there's been artifacts found on the Earth in strata, which is 3.5 billion years old.
Oh, yeah.
So this Earth is not what you think it is. This place has been the home of some extraordinarily brilliant civilizations. Hundreds of millions of years ago. So, and then that begs the question, well, what is really going on here? Who is God? You know, where do we really come from? I think I would conclude by saying, I believe that we are being led on the earth today. The human family is being led by an extraterrestrial dark force that's come to this earth. Maybe a long time ago, maybe recently, within the last 10,000 years, but whatever it is, it's highly intelligent, whoever they are, wherever they've come from, and they are profoundly, in our system of thinking, they are profoundly evil. They don't seem, whoever these entities are, they do not seem to care a damn about the human race. They care
not
only
at all.
For themselves.
Not about life or death, no more than we would care
None
about ants.
That's it. And so I think that there's something going on here that I know that there's, for lack of a better term, alien life forms here. You know, the Christians call them good and bad angels, demons and devils and poltergeists, and or whatever they are, they're in a different dimension, and they're very, very evil. And they are taking over the earth, and so that's why I said in the beginning, I'm kind of wondering what is the creators of the human race, what are they going to do about what's going on? Because the whole human race today has been put under arrest. We cannot grow, we cannot move, we cannot do anything. The whole human race is under arrest.